Hello students, we are in the second part of the chapter number 4 of your history textbook. The chapter's name is the same one as before. This is the Mughal Empire. This is Akbar the Great, who ruled over India from 1556 to 1605. His real name was Jalaluddin Muhammad Akbar and he was born in Amarkot. While his father Humayun was in exile, Humayun had to leave India because Sher Shah Suri had taken away his kingdom, and that was a time when Akbar the Great was born. Akbar was made king after the sudden death of Humayun in 1556. Akbar was just 13 years old then. Humayun had fallen from his library known as Sher Mandal, and he couldn't recover after that and he died. Now, this man, Akbar, is considered the greatest ruler of the Mughal dynasty. He is known as Akbar the Great because he brought back the glory to the Mughal Empire. There was one general known as Hemu. He was an Afghan general, and Akbar could defeat Hemu. Hemu himself was a very powerful man. And after defeating Hemu, Akbar came into power. This happened in the second battle of Panipat when he defeated Hemu. And Akbar ended the regency of Bairam Khan. He took over his kingdom. And he continued these two policies which are important for every ruler. First is conquest and the other is alliance. And this enabled him to consolidate his kingdom. He was conquering new kingdoms and he was making friendship with some rulers, and that made him to have a large kingdom of his own. Now here's a list of the campaigns of Akbar from the year 1561 till year 1598. Now we come to know about him through a book known as Akbarnama, written by Abul Fazl. Now Akbarnama informs us about his rule and his policies which helped him control his empire. Abul Fazl wrote the history in three volumes, and in the first and second volumes they describe the lineage about his ancestry and also the main events which took place during the reign of Akbar the Great. And in the third volume, which is known as N.E. Akbari, Abul Fazl describes the Mughal administration, the Mughal households, the revenue system, the army and so on. Now these are three policies which are important when we talk about Akbar. He wasn't very successful in the third one, but about the first and second, yes, he was largely successful. This is important from exams point of view. Sorry. Now we talk about his policy known as Rajput policy, how he dealt with the Rajputs. Akbar realized that he must have a tolerant approach in order to rule over Hindustan. He had studied about the previous rulers, the previous dynasties, where they had failed and what they did wrong, and that made him to adopt a policy in which he showed his compassionate nature. He treated even the defeated kings with dignity and respect. He knew that they were also kings, like just like he was a king. He never insulted them or humiliated them, even if the king was from a different religious background. Even then he respected them. He knew that warriors who are Rajputs, they are brave people and they are also loyal people. And he needed these qualities in people he wanted to see around himself. And he was very clear about it, and he felt the best way is to be kind to these people. Although these people were weaker than him, that is why he could defeat them in the first place. He even allowed the defeated rulers to rule over their territories. He said, fine, you be loyal to me and you can keep ruling over your own territories. I don't have a problem. So whenever he needed it, these rulers helped him. Whenever Akbar needed an army or contingents, these people always, because he had spared their life, and because the Rajputs were loyal people, they knew what it is to be loyal to a person who did not kill them. And this helped Akbar a lot. Now, the second policy is the matrimonial alliance. He married the eldest daughter of Raja Barmal. Now, this Raja Barmal or Bihari Mal was a ruler of Amber in Rajasthan. And he had a daughter known as Harka Bai. Now, he came into matrimonial alliance with him, and this Raja Barmal became his Sambandhi. Now, that put a moral binding over Raja Barmal and over the other Rajputs also who were in the favor of Raja Barmal not to fight with this Mughal king known as Akbar, because they had become equal now. Now, this enabled him to get the powerful support of Amber throughout his reign. And since Akbar was tolerant and sensitive, this man was also tolerant. He was sensitive. He had taken a Hindu girl to be his wife. Now, he allowed his Hindu wives to have complete religious freedom. They could perform their pujas. They could go to the temple. And whatever festivals the Hindus celebrate in Hindu context, they could do everything in his kingdom. That made him very popular. And he also, because he knew that the Rajputs are loyal people and trustworthy people, he gave them high posts in the administration in his kingdom, in his empire. So he had Rajput kings like Raja Bhagwan Das and Raja Man Singh, who were his trusted officials. But some Rajput states like Ranthambore and Jodhpur, they did not submit to Akbar. They said, "We don't want high posts in your administration." So here's a Mughal painting with Akbar on his throne and some Rajputs around him in his court. Now let's talk about his religious policy. Policy number one, he had a secular attitude. So his followers also did not harbor feelings of hatred for other religions. This is true because people only watch the ruler. If the ruler is secular, the people will be secular. But if the ruler is communal, ruler is communal in nature, the people will also copy that. So when Akbar had a secular attitude, he respected every religion, including his own, including others, and including some other religion which he came to know about. Now, because of this, every person, every citizen, every follower of his, they also did not keep any feeling of hatred about other religions. Either, as well as all the Hindu festivals were celebrated with equal enthusiasm in his kingdom. You know that we do it in our school. We celebrate all the Hindu festivals. We celebrate all the festivals of the Muslims, of the Jainis, of the Buddhists, of the Christians. So that is the kind of policy he had about religions. And he had a place of worship known as Ibadat Khana, and to which he invited ulemas, that are the Muslim religious leaders, even the Brahmins and the Jesuit priests who are Christians, and the Zoroastrians, which are Parsis. They were all invited to this hall of worship, and there he used to discuss issues involving the different religions, different social customs, etc. This is a picture of Ibadat Khana. This is in Fatehpur Sikri in Rajasthan. Now, continuing with his religious policies, he abolished the pilgrim tax for having bath in holy places like Banaras and Prayag. Prayag is Allahabad now, and Banaras is Varanasi. So, people from Hindu religion could have the bath in the holy river without having to pay an extra tax on that. And he also removed the tax known as jizya, which was paid only by people who were not Muslims. So there, in these two, he made Hindus and Muslims on the equal platform. They could feel free about and happy about their religions and their religious rituals. In the earlier days, when the prisoner of war was taken, he was forcefully converted to Islam. Now he stopped the practice of converting prisoners of war into Islam. So if the Hindu prisoner was captured, if a Hindu soldier was captured in a war, he could remain a Hindu. There was no fear of him to be converted to Islam. They celebrated every Hindu festival. He allowed construction of Hindu temples, and often he was to give a lot of money to the Hindu temples which were already existing. He even got the Ramayana and the Mahabharata translated into Persian so that more people could read it. Now he practiced something known as Sulha Ikul. Now this means universal peace. And the aim of this was to remove from the mind of people. The feeling of differences in classes, creed and religious beliefs. He strongly condemned and did not tolerate the differences in classes, creeds and religions. The intolerance was what he did not tolerate. So the Sunnis and Shias met in the same mosque and the Christians and the Jews in the same church. This is the king himself, the emperor himself, with people of different faiths sitting around him in a meeting of Sulha Ikul. Now there's something else which is similar, known as Tawhid-e-Ilahi. It is also known as a divine faith. It was like a religion, but it was not a religion. After listening to and interacting with people of different religions, Akbar came to a conclusion that all religions give the same message of peace, respect and love. So he felt that the common ideals of all religions could be combined to form a new religious path. This is a religious path, it is not a religion. He was also not going against his own religion of Islam. Now this he called as Tawhid-e-Ilahi, and he himself became the guide for that. Now in this picture, in this Mughal painting, you can see these two gentlemen on the left in dark dress. They are the Jesuits, they are the Christians. They had the same access to Tawhid-e-Ilahi discussions as Hindus or Zoroastrians or from any other religion, even Islam. Now as per the writings of Abul Fazl in Ain-e-Akbari, which is the third volume of Akbarnama, this was a very simple religious path, and it even discouraged the killing of animals. It also prohibited the custom of sati. Sati is when there was an attack on the kingdom by Muslims, and there was a fear of losing. The women in the palace or in the kingdom used to burn themselves. Or they used to burn themselves if their husband had died on the pyre of their husbands. So he prohibited this custom. There were no priests and no places of worship, and there were no rituals in Tawhid-e-Ilahi, and he himself was a spiritual guide. But the problem is, just like today, whenever we talk about religious feelings, people tend to have their own religious beliefs. Whether they are right or wrong, they still stick to it. They do not want somebody else to tell them what to do or what to believe. Similar was the problem with Tawhid-e-Ilahi. Tawhid-e-Ilahi had one more name. It is known as Deen-e-Ilahi. Then they both are same. But this Deen-e-Ilahi or Tawhid-e-Ilahi did not become popular, as only few people accepted it. Now, one of those few people was Birbal. He was one minister in the court of Akbar. and Birbal was a Hindu, and he accepted Tawheed-e-Ilahi. But Akbar never forced anybody to accept it. If they accept it, fine. If they don't, it's perfect. It was perfectly all right with them. The path lost its importance after Akbar's death, but his son Jahangir, he remembered the ideas what his father used to follow, and he followed them to some extent. Now Akbar, when he was 63 years of age, he died of illness, and this happened in the October of 1605. Now we talking about the next emperor of the Mughal dynasty. His name was Jahangir, and he ruled over India from the year 1605 to 1627. His real name was Nuruddin Salim. He was the eldest son of Akbar, and Jahangir itself means the ruler of the world. He is well known to provide justice to all. He was known as a justice giver, and he inherited a very solid empire that his father had built based on his policies with religion, with the Rajputs, and with Tawheed-e-Ilahi. Now when we look at the military campaigns of Jahangir, he tried to consolidate the empire he inherited from his father Akbar. His first major challenge was his own son. His own son Khusro rebelled against his father Jahangir, but he could crush it with a strong hand that might have put him in bad books with his son Khusro. He tightened his control over Awadh, which is in Uttar Pradesh now, and Bengal, and he managed to end the long standing conflict between Mewar and the Mughals. Mewar was in Rajasthan. He defeated Rana Amar Singh of Mewar, but his father Akbar the Great would have, just like his daddy would have done, he allowed the defeated ruler to have control over his territory, just like Akbar the Great used to respect and give dignity to the people he had defeated. Now the only condition was these people who have been defeated and are left alive should be loyal towards the Mughals, because they have had left them alive. He subdued the Afghans in Bengal, but he was not successful in the Deccan states. The commander of Ahmednagar did not allow him to conquer any territories in the Deccan. Now the autobiography of Jahangir, that is the biography that he wrote of himself, about himself, is Tuzuk-e Jahangiri, and which portrays him to be a man of justice. The first order which he gave after becoming the empire was to strengthen the system of justice, and he set up something known as a chain of justice. This was a chain made up of gold, and it was very long, and it had 60 bells on it. So one end of the chain was fastened to the fort in Agra, and the other one to a stone post on the bank of River Yamuna, and anybody who wanted justice, sought justice, could pull the chain, ring the bells, get the attention of the emperor, and get justice done to himself. This painting shows the chain of justice. The river is Yamuna, and there's a post on which the chain is fastened. And this is what the government of India has put about this chain of justice, or Zanjeer-e-Adl. The chain is gone, of course, because it was gold. But the spot where he put it has been marked by the government. You can read this at your leisure. Now he married a lady known as Mehrunisa in 1611, and he himself gave the title of Noor Jahan to his wife. Noor Jahan means light of the world. She was very talented, intelligent, and beautiful, and often this emperor sought the advice of his wife on important issues. And whenever the king was not there, this lady was capable enough to handle the affairs of the empire whenever Jahangir was absent. He minted silver coins bearing his own title on one side, and he mentioned that it is in the honor of his wife, Nur Jahan. Now, Nur Jahan had a brother known as Shahryar, and because this man loved his wife so much, he wanted to promote Shahryar to the throne. But her efforts, the efforts also taken by Nur Jahan to put her brother on the throne, that made Jahangir unpopular with Prince Khurram. We'll come to know about that little later. That is Jahangir and Nur Jahan. Jahangir, lot of Europeans started coming to his empire, and several English traders came to India during his reign, and they started seeking concessions from the king, from the emperor. And two such people were Captain William Hawkins and Sir Thomas Rowe. Both of them were from East India Company, which later was the cause of the British's ruling over India. So this is how it happened. These two were sent to the Jahangir's court, and Jahangir, just like he was giving permission and concessions to other rulers, he gave them also permission. He granted them permission to set up a trading post, and it was set up in a place called Surat, which is in Gujarat now, in the year 1612. And he also granted them many trading rights and concessions. Now, in this painting, you can see Jahangir and these two people from the British court. This is Jahangir's tomb in Shahdara. I will talk about Shahjahan. He ruled from 1627 till 1658, and his real name was Prince Shahabuddin Muhammad Khurram. Now, he was Jahangir's son, and when Nur Jahan and Jahangir tried to promote Nur Jahan's brother Shahryar to the throne, he was the one who was not happy because he felt that the throne belonged to him after his father died. So what he did was he defeated his brother-in-law Shahryar in 1627, and he ascended the throne. He was given the title Shahjahan. Shahjahan means the ruler of the world. There's an error here. He was not his brother-in-law, he was his maternal uncle or mama. Now, Shahjahan witnessed many revolts, and he had to march against the Bundela Rajputs to crush the revolts. The revolt in Deccan soon followed, and Shahjahan invaded Deccan in 1633, and he took over Ahmednagar and Bijapur and Golconda. Bijapur and Golconda were two important centers. Bijapur is in Karnataka today, and Golconda is a place near Hyderabad. The rulers of these two places, they signed a peace treaty with Shahjahan and agreed to pay an annual amount like a tribute, and they promised to remain loyal to Shahjahan. Now, this victory made Shahjahan very ambitious. This is Golconda Fort in a place near Hyderabad. Now, we talk about his campaigns. He wanted to add Taimur's capital Samarkand to his empire, just like his predecessors had wanted to do. So he sent his armies to Balkh and Badkashan, but he was not successful. The next failure happened when he tried to recover Kandahar from the ruler of Persia. Kandahar is in present day Afghanistan. Now, let us see how he dealt with the European traders. His father had given concessions and permissions and grants to European traders, especially the British traders, and especially to the British East India Trading Company. Now, the European traders continued their trading activities during the reign of Shahjahan, as they had done during his father's time. Now, people from Portugal also came. These Portuguese established themselves as independent traders in Bengal. But soon they became troublemakers. And they stopped paying customs, they stopped paying duties, they stopped paying taxes. And Shahjahan had to fight against them and made them to comply with the terms of the trade of his empire. Now, who else visited his kingdom? There were missionaries, there were merchants, there were foreign travelers who visited India in the 16th, 17th and 18th, in the earlier part of the 18th century. And they wrote about the reigns of Shahjahan and Aurangzeb. And the following three are the accounts, travels in the Mughal Empire written by Bernier, travels in India by Tavernier, and Storia de Magor by Manakhi. Now, the Europeans' accounts on Shahjahan, Bernier writes about Shahjahan as being like a father ruling over his family. He was tough, strong, and capable ruler, and his military campaigns were very well planned and executed. He is known for architecture. He is known for building gardens also. He was very much interested in architecture. He built the famous Taj Mahal at Agra. He even built a new city named it after himself, known as Shahjahanabad. This he did as the seventh city of Delhi. And this he made his own capital. This is Taj Mahal, a very beautiful view of it. Now, there was no clear law of succession in the Mughal dynasties. Now, when we talk about his successors, this is a problem. He fell ill in the year 1657, and even though he had not died, there was a war of succession between his four sons, Dara Shuko, Shuja, Murad and Aurangzeb. Now, his son Aurangzeb, he killed the main rival, that is the eldest brother, Dara Shuko, because he feared that Dara Shuko could become the emperor. He killed his brother and ascended the throne in 1658. And the surprising part was, this was before his daddy had died, before Shahjahan had died. He made himself an emperor. What he did was he imprisoned his daddy, his sick father, at Agra Fort, and he crowned himself as the emperor. And in the Agra Fort, in the year 1666, Shahjahan died. This is Shahjahan's tomb, and the grave next to his is of his wife. This is the end of part 2 of the 3 parts of this video, of this chapter. And give it a thumbs up and be sure to watch the third and the last part of this chapter. Bye till then.